Would take your hymnal, turn to number 11. Number 11. Today we're going to sing some songs of praise to Christ for all that He is, all that He has done. Stand with me as we sing. Come Thou Fount. Come Thou Fount of every blessing, to my heart to sing Thy praise. Streams of mercy never ceasing, call for songs of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, some by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I'm fixed upon it, mount of Thy redeeming love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by Thy help I come, and I hope by Thy safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger, interposed His precious blood. Oh, to praise how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let Thy grace, Lord, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to Thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, Lord, take and seal it for Thy courts above. Let's turn over to number 192. Crown Him with many crowns.
Crown Him with many crowns, the Lamb upon His throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing.
Shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This is God's word.
We're going to go a little off script. This next song is not in the bulletin number 19. We're going to sing the first and the last, and to God be the glory.
To God be the glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life and atonement for.
Sitting down, and this time when we get to the chorus, Miss Mamie's going to stop playing, and I want you guys, I know this church isn't full, but there's plenty of folks here to raise the roof anyway, and I really want you to sing out as we get to that chorus on verse 4.
Great things he hath taught us, great things he hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport, when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
Don't sit down yet. They did in the first service. Everybody had a seat as soon as we finished. But don't sit yet. We're going to sing, There is a Redeemer.
Sunday here, and so if you see Jordan around, give him a really hard time about about leaving, but we're sad that he's going, but we're also excited about the opportunity that he has in front of him. I think he's going to be singing maybe next Sunday, I believe I'm right about that, so we can throw stuff at him next Sunday one last time. But we're excited for Jordan, so be praying for him as he starts this new chapter of his life. Matthew chapter 28, I asked you to turn there, and I'm not even there myself. There we go, Matthew 28, verse 16 through 20. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you, and behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." I've shared this before, so I apologize to share it again, but one of my favorite fishing spots in the world is a small underwater mound that's only about 20 feet by 20 feet. If the fish are there and you're able to stay on top of it, it's one of the best places in the world. You're in luck. But if the wind is strong and the waves start rocking the boat and your anchor can't hold, you look up and all of a sudden you discover that you've drifted off that favorite spot. You don't have to be a fisherman to experience that. Most of us here, I assume, have probably been out on boats, and so we remember what it's like to be on a boat and to look up and all of a sudden see that we drifted maybe far away from the bank or far from where we first started. But drifting doesn't just happen with boats. Drifting can happen in a person's life. A Christian, for example, an individual believer, can at one time be walking closely hand in hand with the Lord, and then over the course of time, he or she can look up and see that they drifted far away from the Lord in their relationship. Drifting can also happen for a church, even a church like ours. I don't have to tell you that there are numerous Christian institutions, should I say, there are institutions and organizations that began as Christian in America, but over the course of time, they've lost their way. America is filled with organizations like that. They started out as Christian, but now they're almost entirely secular. Y'all with me? And so it can happen to any Christian organization. It can happen to any Christian church. See, over the course of time, groups like this lost the sight of their mission, or, as is commonly expressed, they had a mission drift. Little by little, gradually, over the course of time, they drifted away from their true mission. But that begs the question, what is our mission as a church? What is our mission as a church? Well, in our passage this morning, Jesus provides us with the mission for any church that wants to follow after him. He gives us the mission that we are to take as our task until he returns for his church. And so this morning, what I want to do for the balance of our time is to look at this very familiar passage and to ask and answer three basic questions. So I want to ask, first of all, what is the mission of the church according to Jesus? Secondly, we'll ask, how do we accomplish this mission? And then finally, where does the mission actually take place? So those three questions, and then we're through. What is the mission for the church? How do we go about accomplishing it? And then finally, where does it actually take place? So think first of all, okay, what is the mission for the church according to Jesus? Right before he ascended back into heaven, after the crucifixion, after his being raised from the dead, before his ascension back into heaven, he tells his disciples here, Matthew 28, here's your mission. I want you to go and make other disciples. That's the mission of the church, to make disciples. Everything else we're going to talk about today flows out of this main idea that Jesus gives, this main imperative to the disciples. I want you to make other disciples. The going we're going to talk about, the baptizing, the teaching, all of that flows out of the central command to make disciples. But what does it actually mean to make disciples? I grew up, like most of you, in the South.
And the church I grew up in Alabama, or was converted in rather, the language that we used most often there to describe being a child of God was the term saved. So someone might ask you the question, are you saved? Some trying to witness somebody that's not a Christian and say, are you saved? Or even within the church, we talk a lot about being saved, making sure that we were saved. And that's appropriate. There's nothing wrong with that at all, because the Bible uses that language, doesn't it? Romans chapter 10, we're told, we're given the promise that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be, you can finish the sentence, they shall be saved. We know that the Apostle Paul says in Ephesians chapter 2 that it is by grace we have been saved through faith. It's not of ourselves, it's the gift of God. And so the Bible uses this language. It's appropriate for us to talk about being saved. I'm a saved individual if I trust in Jesus. But as we kind of take a step back and look at the rest of the Bible, we come to understand that there are more terms to describe being a child of God than simply being saved. So we might also, especially in our section here of America in the South, we might also use the term, I am a Christian. Or you might ask someone else, are you a Christian? And that's certainly an appropriate label or designation to talk about somebody that really belongs to God, is a child of God, you're a Christian. But what we also should see as we study the scripture is that the term that's before us this morning is also an appropriate label for anybody that's really saved, anybody that's really a child of God or a Christian. We can also say that person is a disciple. In other words, we should not have in our minds that being saved or being a Christian is one thing, and being a disciple is something kind of next level. Or that being saved or being a Christian, the terms we normally use, is what, you know, that's kind of the base package. But then being a disciple is something that's optional. It's for the spiritually elite crowd. Now in the Bible, it seems clear to me at least that being saved and being a disciple are the same thing. That the call to be saved is this call also to be a disciple of Jesus. So even though we don't use the term around here a lot, at least in my experience, are you a disciple of Jesus? It's certainly appropriate if we're saved, we're Christians, to say I'm a disciple of Christ. So Jesus tells his disciples, it's the original 11, I want you to make other disciples. In fact, you may remember this in the book of Acts chapter 11, thinking about these terms, disciple and Christian. And in the book of Acts chapter 11, we're told that in the city of Antioch, the disciples were first called Christians there. And he's not talking about, Luke in Acts 11 is not talking about the disciples being the only this original 12. He's talking about the church in Antioch. The believers there, he says, the disciples there were first called Christians. And you remember that this was not a term of endearment, this term Christian. It was actually heaped on them by the outside world. They watched how these people lived and they said, these believers, you're just like a bunch of little Christ walking around. You follow after this man named Jesus, you're Christians. But it's instructive for us to see, to the point I'm making here, is that the disciples were first called Christians. They're interchangeable, those terms. Now, as we think about this call that Jesus issues here to his church, this mission we're thinking about, what are we supposed to be doing as a church? He said, you're to be making disciples. We should be reminded this morning that discipleship, this life of being a disciple, starts with the new birth. We're going to talk about this idea that we're supposed to be following after Jesus, but we can't follow after Jesus unless our heart has been changed. Left to ourselves, we do not have the ability or the desire to follow after Christ apart from His Spirit. Left to ourselves, the Bible says that all of us, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us turned to our own way. That all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. There's none righteous, not even one. No one understands. Here it is. No one seeks after God according to the Scripture. So in order for us to have the ability to actually follow Jesus and the desire to do so, we have to be born of God's Spirit. So Jesus told Nicodemus, marvel not that I'm telling you, you must be born again. Literally, you must be born with life from above. And so when a person trusts in Jesus and calls after Him for salvation, we talked about earlier, whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. In a moment of time, when there's genuine repentance, the heart is changed. The Spirit of God comes to make us new on the inside, and He gives us the ability then this new life inside of us, we have the ability and the desire to follow after Jesus. And so discipleship starts with the new birth. And to be a disciple means to be, as we've said, a follower or a learner, you might even say. It's kind of like being an apprentice of Jesus. All the time, though. There are all kinds of apprentice programs. I think a healthy sign in our country, different vocations or trades, apprentice programs where people can learn a skill or a trade on the job by watching someone else do it. They kind of attach themselves to that person that's training them, and this is the idea of being a disciple, except we're not talking about showing up and punching the clock. We're talking about showing up for life, being a lifelong learner or apprentice of Jesus. Think about this idea of following. We use this term follow all the time these days. It can be a good thing in the social media world. For example, I was informed recently by our media expert, Don Forrest, that almost 700 people follow Bethel on Facebook. I had to be informed that because I'm not on Facebook or any other social media platforms. I'm in the dark ages, I know, but John told me we almost have 700 people that follow Bethel on Facebook. And we're thankful for this. And we always invite people to know what's going on here and to watch services when you're not able to be here, so that's a good thing. But take another example in the social media world, Twitter. If you look up a person on Twitter, look up their name, their profile, you can see not only how many people they are following, but you can see how many people say they're following this person, how many followers they have. And it's crazy sometimes when you look up some of the more famous people in our nation and see how many millions of followers. That's what it says. Someone has 2 million, quote, followers. But especially in this kind of world, in the Twitter space, that idea of following is more of a casual following, isn't it? It's following from a distance. It's keeping up on trends or news or something, some quote or whatever the case might be. It's not being having a heart of commitment to follow this person. It's a casual follow. Sometimes I'm afraid that in the church, we have the same mentality of our following with Jesus. That it's a casual sort of thing. Yes, I want to be saved, a person might say. I want to make sure that I'm going to heaven when I die. But my lifestyle, I mean, you're talking about everything belonging to Jesus. If you're following for your life, I don't know about that. Maybe I'll follow from a distance. A pastor named Eugene Peterson several years ago said this: millions of people in our culture make a decision for Christ, but there's a dreadful attrition rate. Many claim to have been born again, but the evidence for mature Christian discipleship is slim. In our kind of culture, anything, even news about God, can be sold if packaged freshly. But when it loses its novelty, it goes on the garbage heap. And then he goes on to describe what discipleship really is long obedience in the same direction. Discipleship is long obedience in the same direction. In other words, being a Christian is not just about a decision you make at a point in time, as important as the decision is, it's being in it for the long haul. It's a continual following after the Lord Jesus. It's what being a Christian is. As it's expressed in the hymn, words it this way: I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. Have you made that decision in your life? No matter what the cost, no matter what the cost might be, you have decided that you are going to follow Jesus all the way to the end. That's what being a disciple is. And that's what Jesus says is the mission of the church. He tells these disciples, I want you to go down and make disciples. That's the mission. That's question number one. What's our mission? It's to make disciples as a church. Secondly, how do we accomplish it as a church? Well, he gives us clues in the text as to how we're to accomplish this as a church. Notice that he says, I want you to go therefore and make disciples of all nations. Here's the first clue: baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And so he tells us as a church, we are to be baptizing people. Baptizing. So when a person makes a profession of faith in Jesus, we are to baptize them. Baptists maintain, just as a side note, but important, Baptists maintain that baptism by immersion is the proper mode of baptism.
Because baptism by immersion is the mode the Bible speaks of, and it's the one that most accurately captures what's being communicated in baptism. So what's being communicated in baptism visually, when a person is taken under the water, submerged under the water, then brought back up out of the water, what's being communicated visually is symbolic of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. And this person is saved when they're being baptized, and they have been united spiritually to Christ. They are saying, by going through this rite of baptism, they are saying they have died in their old way of life as they go under the water, and they've been raised to walk in newness of life. That's what baptism is saying visually. As many people have said, baptism is an outward sign or a symbol of an inward spiritual change that's already taken place in the person's heart. So Jesus says, when people decide to follow him, I want you to baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Now, often you'll hear well-intentioned Christians, or even preachers, for that matter, say something like this related to baptism. They'll say, baptism isn't essential for salvation. Baptism isn't essential for salvation. What most of them mean when they say that, I think, is that baptism isn't what saves a person. And of course, that's absolutely true. Baptism is not what saves anyone. I can't tell you how many times the man that led me to the Lord used to say, you can get baptized as many times as you want. And every creek around here, to all the tadpoles, know you by name. But if you haven't repented of your sin and trusted in Jesus, you'll just get wet. We understand that we can't do any religious practice. We can't go through any ritual that will make us right with God. We understand that salvation comes by faith alone in Christ alone, by God's grace alone. However, having said all this up front, it's important to maintain that baptism is essential. Because if we say that baptism isn't essential, it doesn't save us. We get that. We know that going through in the water is not what saves us at all. It's Jesus that saves us. But if we say that baptism isn't essential, someone might conclude, well, baptism is optional. Right? I mean, if baptism isn't essential, maybe it's optional. Going back to what I said earlier, kind of like you're buying a new car. I couldn't imagine buying a brand new car these days, but if you had a chance to order one, and they say, okay, here's the base package, you get the car, and you get in on the base package, or you can get these other options, all the bells and whistles. So the person might say, well, I'll take the base package. I want to be a Christian. I want to go to heaven. But if it's optional about being baptized, I don't think I want to do that yet. And so what I'm saying here is that this isn't optional. Jesus actually commanded us to go through this symbol, which is an outward sign of inward change. He commanded his followers to undergo this rite to demonstrate their initial faith in him. Baptism typically signals the beginning of our life of faith and our following of Jesus. It is the high point of the church when we celebrate what God has done in someone else's life. And it's also a tremendous step for a person to take. Especially in other cultures. It requires a lot of courage in other cultures. When someone decides to follow Jesus and then the pastor says, okay, you need to be baptized, in a lot of other cultures today, it means they're being cut off from their family. It means some people are writing them off. But baptism is a huge step for anyone to publicly declare that they're a Christian. And that's what baptism is. It is the biblical testimony, the biblical way to say, I have started following Jesus. The biblical testimony is not raising your hand at the end of a service. If a pastor says, I want every head to bow, every eye to close, every Christian to pray. You ever heard that? We all hear that, Pastor. I've used that before. We all use that from time to time. But someone says, if you want to become a Christian, raise your hand. That's a good thing to raise your hand, but that's not the way you communicate biblically that you've decided to follow Jesus. Neither is it walking down the aisle. Now, I hope if you feel led, hear the invitation to walk down the aisle, that you'll come. But walking down the aisle doesn't mean you've really decided to follow Jesus, according to the Bible. Neither is signing up a card. The biblical way to demonstrate that you decided that your life now belongs to Jesus is to get in the baptismal waters to publicly declare that. People who get baptized baptize need our ongoing prayers, words of encouragement, and support, because it signals the start of a lifelong journey. The start of a lifelong journey. So that's what Jesus says. Our mission is to make disciples. Once they're made, that is, once they decide to follow Jesus, we're to baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then he says, I want you to be teaching them to observe or to obey all things whatsoever I've commanded you. I mentioned in the first service, isn't that a pesky little word, all? And Jesus says, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. All that I have commanded you. So here comes the lifetime part. We're still thinking about the second question, how do we accomplish this, making disciples? Jesus tells it involves teaching. This is the lifetime part. In other words, baptism signals the start of our new life in Christ and this new way of life, which is what Jesus is inviting us into, a new way of life. So discipleship now is learning and obeying the commands of Jesus. Obedience to the commands of Christ doesn't secure my salvation, but obedience to his commands, that's a sign that I've actually been born again. So there's a knowledge component here when Jesus says, I want you to teach them whatever I've commanded. There's a knowledge component here, meaning if we're going to obey what he said, we have to first of all know what he commanded. We have to know the scripture. If we're going to call ourselves Christians or disciples of Jesus, it makes a lot of sense that we would first know what he actually said. But it's more, it goes more, as you can clearly see, than just knowing head knowledge or facts or memorizing all the commands we have in Scripture. Because Jesus says, I want you to teach them to do what? To obey. I want you to teach them to observe all that I have commanded you. So it's head, yes, knowledge, knowing what he said, but it's also heart and will doing what he said. As we think about this, Jesus commanded a lot of things in the Bible, didn't he? You read through the gospel narratives, you'll discover a few examples. Like he said, I want you to pray for your enemies. Seek first the kingdom of God. Forgive those who have wronged you. Give to the poor. Turn the other cheek. This could go on. And literally, it does. One author named Bill Hull suggests that Jesus commanded 212 things in the gospels. 212 commands that he summarizes or boils down to three basic things. Number one, love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Number two, love your neighbor as yourself. Number three, love your enemies. And all the commands can be summed up in those three ways. I agree with that summation, but I would quickly add, as we think about what Jesus commanded, that he also commanded us things through his apostles. So, for example, when the Apostle Peter writes 1 and 2 Peter, whatever Peter commands under the inspiration of the Spirit is also the commands of Jesus, isn't it? The point I want to make right here is simply this, that when Jesus says, I want you to be teaching them to obey all that I've commanded, this is our curriculum as a church. This is your curriculum as a Christian. Your curriculum is a set course of study, right? It leaves out some things. We're not going to study that. This is what we're going to focus on. And a curriculum is a set course of study. If you go to a college and you say, I want to be this or that, I want to study this or that, there'll be a required number of hours you've got to take. And then there'll also be a required list of courses. One of my jobs at the college as a teacher is also I have to advise students, which is a scary thing, to advise them for classes, but somehow they're able to graduate in 4 or 5 years, even with me as their advisor. But anyway, I have to sign students up for classes and say, okay, here's what you need to take. And sometimes they get in courses and they want to get out of the courses once they discover what the course is actually like. They want to drop it. But sometimes I have students that are so stubborn-willed, I say, okay, here's the classes you've got to take. And they say, I don't want to take those classes. They wish that there was a program where they could graduate, where they could take all electives. You know, I just want to take the classes that I want to take. There's no such program that exists, as far as I'm aware of, at least not at our college. And sometimes we approach, maybe you don't, maybe I'm speaking more for myself, maybe we approach the Christian life in the same way that it's just about electives, and I want to be free to embrace what I want to embrace in the Bible and then free to leave what I don't want to take. That makes sense? Yes, I'm okay with these commands of Jesus because those things fit my current lifestyle. But when there's something that confronts me and hits me right between the eyes, that's a clear command from Jesus, I say, you know what? I'll sleep with it. That ever happened in your life? When there's a clear command in Scripture that confronts you head on with something you're doing in your life or something Jesus wants you to do, you have the free will as a human being. God made you that way to say yes or no. But what Jesus is teaching us here, what the rest of the Bible teaches us, is we want to call ourselves Christians. That means we are committed to doing what Jesus said to do. What being a Christian is. The curriculum is already set for us as a church. So that's how we accomplish the mission. Our mission is to make disciples. Jesus says you do that by baptizing and by teaching, and that's over a lifetime. But where does the mission actually take place? This won't take as long. Jesus says that we're to be doing it in all the nations, and we're doing it as we're going. Notice in verse, if you still have your Bible open, he says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations. All nations. The word that's used for nations here in the original language is the word ethne. And so you probably hear the term we would use today, ethnic. It simply means people groups. So when Jesus said, I want you to make disciples of all nations, to these original 12, remember? I want you to make disciples of all nations. He was talking much more than simply geographical nations that existed at the time. He's literally saying, I want you to make disciples of all the people groups of the world. That's why, by the way, the Colwells have been working so hard to raise the support to get back to Japan, because they believe that all peoples in the world, including the people in Japan, need to hear the gospel. This is where disciples should be made, in all the world. This is what you should get used to, by the way, in heaven. If you're a Christian, one day you're going to be with people from every tongue, tribe, and nation. God is not a respecter of persons. Think about this scene in Revelation chapter 7 at the end of time when John says, after this I looked and behold a great multitude that no one could number from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands and crying out with a loud voice, salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. That's what's coming. That is what's coming from every tongue, tribe, and nation. God is not a respecter of persons. It doesn't matter a person's skin color, their background, their race. None of that matters. God so loved what? The world that he gave his only begotten Son. Whosoever will may come and take of the water of life freely. And so since Jesus died for all, the gospel should be proclaimed to all. To all the nations. That's what Jesus said. And when you read the book of Acts, remember we're here in Matthew 28. Jesus is about to go back into heaven. He's telling his disciples, I want you to make disciples in all the nations. When you read the book of Acts, you'll discover they start in Jerusalem. Then they spread out to Judea, Samaria, and finally wind up in the uttermost parts of the earth. They do exactly what Jesus told them to do. They started with their own people group, and then they had to move out to the Samaritans. They had to move out to the pagans. Because they understood what Jesus said is what we're supposed to do. Let's go. And so for us as a local church, we have our own Jerusalem. We have a context or a place where we're called to reach people with the gospel. People within maybe a rock's throw of this church need to hear about Jesus. People are lost in our community, people that don't know Jesus. So we can talk about going to the nations, but we need to start in our own backyard first. And then there's our involvement in home missions, Judea and Samaria, and then the uttermost parts of the earth, partnering with international missions, because we see that Jesus said, make disciples of all nations. But he also said, I want you to go. You see that in verse 19. I want you to go, therefore, and make disciples. Since all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me, go, therefore. You could also translate it, as you are going. And so, certainly there's a need for people to go to unreached people groups around the world. But this verse is also showing us that making disciples happens as we're going here. In other words, it happens as you go about your normal everyday life, as you go about your routines, that we are seeking to make an impact right here where we are. Some people are, yes, called to go overseas. Some people are called to leave family and familiarity behind. Yet some are called to bear witness to Jesus right here at home, to make disciples here. Maybe you remember that story of Mark chapter 5, the Gerasene demoniac. You want a biblical example of this? Someone that wasn't called to go somewhere else, but to stay. The Gerasene demoniac, who had been delivered by Jesus from this demon possession and this destructive life. After he's delivered by Jesus, we find him sitting at the feet of Jesus, clothed and in his right mind. His life has been radically changed forever. And when Jesus and the disciples want to go, it's time for them to leave. This man also wants to go with them. He wants to follow after Jesus wherever Jesus goes. And Jesus tells him, no, you're not going to go with me. But instead, he says, go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you, how he's had mercy on you. And he went away and began to proclaim in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him. And everyone marveled. You see, this is where it starts. As you are going, make disciples. If you're a disciple of Jesus, you can make other disciples right where you are. For us as parents, it starts in our home, doesn't it? If we make disciples in other places, but we fail to make disciples in our own homes, we fail miserably. Now, free will is involved, and children have to make the faith their own. All that's included. We understand this, but it starts first in our homes, and then it spreads out into our community as we are going. That's where the mission is accomplished. Not some far-off exotic place, but right here, right now. The good news for all of us is that God is calling us to be disciples of Jesus. To be saved, yes, to be Christian, but that also means he's calling us to be disciples of Jesus. Like I mentioned earlier, that means we first acknowledge that we're sinners in need of salvation, and we turn to Jesus. We turn our life over to him. He has promised that whoever comes to him, he will never cast, he will never turn us away. Whoever comes to me, I will never cast away, Jesus says. And when you come to him, he gives you the gift of his Spirit. This is this new life, this new power that lives within you as a Christian, the Holy Spirit. And he calls you into a lifetime of following after Jesus. He gives you this ability now and this desire to follow Jesus. Are you a disciple of Jesus? Remember that account in one of the Gospels where Simon and his brother Andrew were called to be disciples? Passing alongside the Sea of Galilee, Jesus saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. The Bible says immediately they left their nets and began to follow him. Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. He says the same thing to you. This morning, follow me. Be my disciple. And I'll make you fishers of men. I want you to make other disciples. You may say to yourself, man, that sounds impossible. That mission, first of all, to be a disciple, you don't know my life. You don't know all the stuff that I've messed up. You don't know where I am. You don't know my sphere of influence. You're saying, I can make disciples. You don't know the world I live in. It sounds like mission impossible. Left to yourself, it would be impossible. Jesus says in the last verse, behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age.
Amen.
His presence makes all the difference.
Amen.
Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word that's settled in the heavens. Lord, we confess that sometimes we need it to be settled, written on our hearts by your Spirit. So as a church, we pray you will forgive us for sometimes not keeping this command central to make disciples. Lord, help us to do better as a church. Help us to have hearts that are in tune with your Spirit, that you're always at work in this world, drawing people to yourself. And so help us to be involved with that. Lord, if there's someone here that needs to make a decision to follow you for the first time, I pray you'll give them the grace they need to respond. And Lord, if there's a Christian here that needs to make a decision in their life to follow, I pray you help them. these things.